hand and he'll pass one down to you when he's doing that. And while that's going on, we're going to have Jim Engel doing his presentation on controlling terrestrial invasive species on your property. Jim has operated White Oak Nursery in Canandaigua for over 20 years. He grows over 80 species of native trees and shrubs and is actively involved in habitat restoration of natural areas. He works with private individuals, land trusts, New York State DEC, and other conservation organizations. So please help me welcome Jim. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Is this on?
How's this going?
No, it's... Is it on now?
Nope. We might need you to...
How about now? Nope.
We don't know where Betsy went.
Can you hear from... if I talk louder? Okay. But first, I just wanted to mention that I have a handout on methods for control. I put some up on the back table there, so if you want to just take a copy. Also on my website, I have a lot of the same information, so you can access it at any time. So we heard a lot about invasive species, and most of the ones that were talked about today are really difficult for the homeowner to control. But I'm going to give you some tools where you can kind of take revenge on some of the plants that you'll find in your backyard or in preserves or wherever you happen to be working.
Jim, I think you need to use that handheld mic.
Okay.
It's turned on.
Is it turned on?
Does it got a green light?
How about now? Yeah, it's green.
I know one more thing to do.
I have one more trick up my sleeve.
No. Volume?
Oh,
hey. Good deal.
I've got a new job at AV when I'm done. Maybe not.
Yeah, so most of the, a lot of the invasive plants you find out in the wild are common ornamental plants that were escaped from your yard, and Brian mentioned some of the alternative native plants that you can use instead. It also highlights the reason for using natives instead of using non-native ornamentals to prevent potential escape and new invasives from invading natural areas. So some of the factors contributing to invasives dominating over time. So in general, you need disturbed habitat. So you need kind of an open niche. And if you have a diverse native plant community, generally you don't have a serious problem with invasives. So generally you have some kind of disturbance, and that usually that's human in nature. And then you need a seed source. And so that seed source has to be available if you're going to have the beginning of an invasive problem. And then most of those invasives have the ability to colonize early, and they establish very easily under a wide range of growing conditions and habitats. And then generally they have a high ability to reproduce and to spread. And many of the plants mature at a very early age, and so they have ability to get established very, very quickly. And then often those plants have the ability to really put on a lot of growth and basically outcompete either the native plants that are there or take advantage of that open niche and really dominate. And the other factor is generally those plants don't have any control on their population. So they come from another part of the globe, they left their herbivores behind, the pathogens that would normally keep their population in check from that area. And the other factor is that here there's no human intervention to kind of keep their population in check or eliminate them from that habitat. And then the other factor that contributes is time. And that kind of magnifies all those other factors. So the longer the invasive is allowed to grow, the bigger the problem. So I'm going to cover some of the some of the techniques that I use and that other people use for controlling invasives. So I'm going to cover the cut stump treatment. It's called hack and squirt. Everybody likes that name. Basil bark treatment, some foliar broadcast sprays, spots treatments, and then some of the manual methods, mowing and cutting. And generally that doesn't provide, you know, long-term permanent control. And then pulling and digging, which everybody likes to do, but it's a lot of work and it's not very practical in large populations. So the cut stump treatment is what I use primarily. And the reason I use it, it basically works for all woody plants. So anything that has a woody stem that you can cut, you can use a cut stump treatment. That goes from multi-flora rows to any kind of tree or shrub. So you want to use the easiest method to cut the stem. And I'm going to cover different methods shortly. You also want to cut as close to the ground as possible. And the reason for that is that if you cut high on the stem, even though you cut the top part of the plant away, there's a potential for the base to resprout. So the closer to the ground you cut, then the less likely the plant will be to resprout. You can use it in any season, spring, summer, fall, and winter. Some people think it has to be done during the growing season, but I do most of my work in the fall and winter. The reason for that is that it's easier to see what you're cutting because there's no foliage on the plants. It's also a cooler time to work, and usually you have more time to go out there and cut than we do during the busy growing season when we're doing other things. So the other key thing is when you do a cut stump treatment is you have to treat the cut surface to prevent that resprouting. So if you only cut it, you're only stimulating the plant to put out new shoots. And next year you're going to have kind of a double the problem because you're going to have multiple shoots coming up. So when you treat the cut surface, generally I apply the herbicide immediately after cut. I've heard that depending on the plant species, you can go back 24 hours, you know, 48 hours and retreat. But there's no need to go back, so I just cut and treat at the same time. And then you're done. And I found with experience and trying different methods that using just a squirt bottle, spray bottle, to apply the herbicide is quick and effective. I know there's many kind of devices out there to apply the herbicide just around the cambium layer, little foam bottles and different things like that, but I find they take longer to apply, so just a spray bottle works for me. And I generally spray every cut stem just to be sure that the plant is going to be treated. And then the material I use most often is just glyphosate, which is the active ingredient in Roundup. And I found from experience that generally a 15% solution of the active ingredient is sufficient to control most plants. You do have to follow the label, and so some labels require 50% active ingredient or 50% solution of the material. So it varies by label, but from my experience using glyphosate, that 15% is sufficient, and that can vary by 5%, either, you know, less or more. The other thing I do is use a dye in the solution, and for the homeowner or the average person, getting the blue pond dye from a pond supplier as a concentrate, and that's readily available, or you can order online. I use a dye indicator that's used for applying herbicides, but the blue pond dye would work just as well. And then another little trick is I found is if you're trying to apply the herbicide during winter time when it's freezing conditions, your spray bottle freezes up, and that's kind of frustrating. So I just found taking some windshield washer fluid and diluting the solution works well. keeps it from freezing and keeps you busy and whacking those invasives. So this is a tool that I use as a brush saw. And so I mentioned, you know, using the tool that is the most efficient and quick to cut the stem. And so this is the device I use. And then afterwards, just spraying each cut surface with the herbicide. And there's a dye involved. And that's really critical. So if you don't spray, and I learned the hard way way back when, you know, I was really aggressive and I cut a lot of buckthorn and everything, didn't treat, and the next year it resprouted. And I just learned the hard way that I had to go back and redo it. So a lot of people have a little chainsaw, and a chainsaw works just as well as a brush saw. Well, not quite as well. It's not as easy to use, but it's very effective. So oftentimes you're dealing with really dense stands of big brush and trees. So again, using power tools, brush saw, chainsaw, is very effective. So you have to deal with with a lot of dense stands. Sometimes it's a monoculture of buckthorn, and so you're dealing with a lot of brush. Just going to give you a little example of the brush saw in action.
Contains several species of invasive thrush: European buckthorn, Asian honeysuckle, multiflora rose. We will cut them using a Johnson forest clearing saw, SC2255. It has a 3.8 horsepower engine and a 9-inch diameter 24 tooth scarlet saw blade. Asian honeysuckle is usually the first invasive shrub to establish in old fields.
Need some sound effects.
Asian honeysuckle is a strong shrub, growing as wide as it is tall. It has a dense cluster of stems emerging from the same root system, which makes it challenging to cut. Honeysuckle will resprout vigorously if not treated. Spray each cut surface with a 50% solution of glyphosate, the active ingredient Roundup. Make sure you read and follow the label for the specific product you are using.
You can see how effective the spray bottle works.
A tree from Europe. When buckthorn grows in the open, like in this field, it usually grows as a multi-stem tree, like these plants. Your forest clearing saw is the only efficient way of cutting large numbers of buckthorn stems.
Well, that's enough of that. I think everybody wants to run out and get their own brush saw.
Should have brought some of this in.
So the other method is if you don't have a power tool, like a chainsaw or a brush saw, and you have a hatchet or an axe or a machete or something like that, you can use the hack and squirt. So basically what you're doing is cutting through the bark of the plant, just making a slash, and then you can spray the herbicide, the glyphosate, down in the cut. You pretty much want to girdle the stem all the way around. And very large stems, you can do a similar thing using the chainsaw and just basically girdle the stem and then apply the herbicide in the cut. So that's killing the plant standing, and then you don't have to deal with the brush, and over time it'll just kind of decompose and fall down. So most people, or a lot of organizations, you know, they like using volunteer labor, and they're kind of gun shy about using power tools, so they resort to loppers. It's effective, but it's kind of limited. And then you have pruning saws, and so with a pruning saw, it takes a lot of elbow grease, and you can't really cut very close to the ground. And you can work on your building your biceps, and you can send them out into a field of honeysuckle, and you probably won't have your volunteers returning anytime soon. So you want to pick the tool that's going to do the job, you know, most efficiently. But here are some other manual tools that are designed specifically for removing certain invasives. So this is a weed wrench. Some of you may have used or are familiar with. So it kind of acts like a pipe clamp. It grips the stem, and you can pull the stem out of the ground. The limitation is, or one of the drawbacks, is that when you pull the stem out of the ground, you're disturbing the soil and potentially creating an environment for more invasive seeds to germinate or some secondary invasives to come in and kind of take over. Another tool that some ingenious guy developed out in the Midwest was a honeysuckle popper. And he spent years kind of developing this, and he markets it. And so it's used for kind of popping the roots of honeysuckle, which usually has 2 to 3 side roots, and you pop a couple of those, and then you can pull like really big honeysuckle out of the ground. But it's somewhat limited and more time consuming. This is a technique I've used once or twice, but not a big fan of. It's a basal bark treatment. And so generally use a herbicide, which is mostly Garlon 4. And so the active ingredient is triclopyr. And you mix that with either diesel fuel or a product called Bark Oil Blue. And that allows the herbicide to be absorbed through the bark into the stem, and it's systemic, and so then it moves down and into the roots and basically kills the plant. The limitation is that it takes a while for the plant to die. Using a lot of material, both the diesel fuel and or oil, and so that's in the environment. And it's kind of slow and messy to apply, because you have to apply 360 degrees around the stem, about a foot high. So you have to get access to all sides of the plant, which is kind of limiting. So I tend to use a brush saw, because when you cut something off, it's done. So kind of cover a few plants here quickly. Asian honeysuckle. A lot of these invasives are, there's certain times of the year when you can identify them easily. So honeysuckle is easy to spot in the springtime. It's one of the first plants to leaf out in the spring. And you can see everything here in green is honeysuckle, and everything that isn't is probably a native that hasn't leafed out yet. Got nice flowers. And then the fruit, close above the fruit, they're often red, sometimes orange, depending on the species. I'm going to skip through these slides pretty quickly. So the handout kind of shows like the different treatments you can use for different sized plants. Some are more effective on large plants, some are more effective on smaller plants. Then European buckthorn. This tends to keep its leaves late into the fall. So after all the native plants have dropped their leaves, the buckthorn still is dark green, so it's easy to identify then. It also has these dark fruit, which stay on the plant into the winter, another identifying feature. And you can see how it really dominates old fields to the exclusion of most other plants. Autumn olive, another invasive. This is when it's in flower. It kind of has a silvery tinge to the foliage. Here are the flowers. So it really stands out when it's in bloom, because it has that silvery look to it, and then the flowers kind of make it stand out against the background. Then it produces fruit in the fall. And some people make jelly out of this, but that wouldn't be a reason I would plant it. So it grows really fast. So this is early stages of invasion. Just a couple of years, you get a really dense, large plants. So it's amazing how quickly this plant grows. It does fix nitrogen, and that's one of the reasons it can take over. Here's an infestation. But using the right tools, a brush saw, just a matter of an hour or so, you can really kind of clean it up. Talked about barberry early. This leaves out early, has bright green foliage, so it kind of stands out against everything else in the woods. Another shot of it. The fruit, when it produces in the fall, is another identifying feature. Also the thorns, the spines along the stems, if you try and grab it and pull it out, you'll notice those very quickly. And then in the fall, it turns bright red color, so another identifying feature. It's a good time to go out and scout and pull out those plants. This is a pale swallowwort. So it has a tendency to kind of climb on itself if it has nothing else to climb. So it kind of twists around itself. It's a shot of the flowers. And then the seed pods that develop, it's in the milkweed family, so it has similar type pods to the native milkweeds. And this is in the spring, so you can see the old stems, the old pods on there, and then the new growth coming up in the springtime. So that's something you can look for as well. And here's a field that I'm in the fourth year of treating. So it looks a lot better than it does in this picture. And if you're trying to control this, and just a few plants, basically if you can dig out the root crown, so it's just where the root crown, where the new shoots initiate. So if you dig those or grub those out, then you've removed the plant. Otherwise, you really have to use a herbicide, a foliar spray. And so for spraying, you want to treat like either at flowering stage or any time after that till fall. What you want to do is try and prevent seed set if you can. If you can't get to it in a timely manner, you can mow the field, let the swallowwort regrow, and then spray after regrowth. The benefit of mowing and then spraying is also that you get separation of the swallowwort from the grass and other forbs there. So it's easier to see the swallowwort, which just tends to be a darker green than all the other foliage. And generally you're going to need multiple years to eliminate a population. And you can use either glyphosate or triclopyr. And the triclopyr is kind of more beneficial because it only affects broadleaf plants and conserves the grass. So in a grassland situation, you can spray over everything. The grass will not be affected, and you can control the swallowwort. And then for small populations, you can just dig out the root crown. Here's a bittersweet, and you can see what it does to trees. It basically wraps around the tree, and as the tree grows, it isn't allowed to grow normally, and so becomes deformed. You can see how massive some of those vines can be. Generally, the oriental bittersweet will flower in the axil of the leaf. And so that's a way to differentiate between the American bittersweet, which produces flowers just on the tip of the growing vines. Also, the American bittersweet on the right has orange kind of seed covering, and the oriental bittersweet has yellow. So another way to differentiate. And also in the fall, the bittersweet has this kind of bright yellow, kind of a lime yellow color to the leaves, and it really stands out against all the other foliage. All the native stuff tends to be other colors, and And this really stands out, so it's a good way to find especially small plants in amongst everything else for pulling or treatment. Just wanted to show a couple of slides here. Indicates how long some of the infestations have been growing without any kind of control. So this is buckthorn discus that were cut, and I counted the growth rings. So yeah, these have been growing for, you know, 4 decades. Here's some autumn olive stems. Not quite as old, but you can see the size of them. So they grow much faster than the size of the growth rings. So it's just an amazing plant. And here's a bittersweet stem, 32 years old. So it just shows that if you take some control action, you know, you can make a difference, because these plants have been growing for so long without any kind of intervention. Just a few points I wanted to make, that something to think about. All infestations start from a single seed. The large infestations are really old. And to make control a priority, and then also provide the funding, whether that's money or labor. And that eradication is possible and is achievable. And control takes time, and so you need to kind of budget your time and kind of plan for the long run. And then it's really important in pristine areas to go out and scout and look for that first plant, that first seed, that may be the beginning of a new infestation. This is a project I worked on a few years ago in the city of Canandaigua. And this was pretty much totally European buckthorn with a few trees involved. So that's what it looked like, the walking trails, just a corridor with buckthorn on either side. And then made a big pile of brush. And the city came in and did some chipping. And that's what it looked like in the spring after it was kind of cleaned up, and we did some planting, or we planted some trees and shrubs and forbs. And then during the first growing season, a lot of the natives that were kind of suppressed by the buckthorn had a chance to regrow, and plus the plants that were installed. And that was the before and the after. So it made a big difference, but it took a lot of negotiating to get the city to agree to undertake this and fund it. And it was really done on a shoestring with a lot of donations from the public. So thank you.